Welcome back. We'll continue with our development of the matrix vector weak form for the linear elliptic PDE with scalar variables in three dimensions. So what we are going to do today is essentially not only complete assembling the matrix vector weak, but also talk a little bit about associated issues which arise mainly from the fact that we are looking at problems here in 3D. So the topic of this segment and the next couple at least is the matrix vector weak form. Recall that we, at the end of the last segment, we were working with the local element level integrals. Okay? And we had developed, again, the local element level matrix vector representations of these integrals. In particular, we worked with the left-hand side integral, the bilinear term. We worked with the forcing function from the right-hand side. And now that brings us to the integral that imposes the Neumann boundary condition. Okay, so let's start with that one. So what we're doing now is to consider the integral integral over partial of omega e sub j of minus WH JN DS. All right. And it's useful right away to recall for ourselves the sort of term we're working with here, right? So the situation we have is the following. We have our basis, we have our domain, and we're looking here at an element that has an edge, or in this case a face really, that coincides with a face of the body of interest itself, right? So we have an element of that type, okay? And the whole point is that in this case, so this is omega e, okay? And we may think of that face as being partial of omega e sub j, okay? And we recall that partial of omega e sub j is the intersection of the boundary of that element omega e with the Neumann boundary of the problem. Okay, so that's really the face of the element upon which we're imposing the Neumann boundary condition. All right, using our finite dimensional basis functions, it takes on the following form. It is now minus integral over that of, of sum of NA CAE JN DS. Now, one thing we've got to be careful about here is that we can indeed consider the sum to be a sum running over the entire set of element nodes, right? And let's start out with writing it in that fashion. Okay? But now we recognize that in this picture that we've drawn here, not all the nodes have corresponding to themselves shape basis functions that are non-zero on the surface of interest, right, on the interface of interest. If we say, for instance, that this is the interface of interest that we've indicated, then let me highlight in a different color the nodes that lie on that boundary. Let's suppose that those are the four nodes lying on that boundary. Okay? It should be pretty clear to us that it is only the basis functions that are one at those nodes that will contribute at all to this integral. Okay? So, having made that observation, there are there are at least a couple of ways in which we can proceed, and the different ways of proceeding simply correspond to different ways of doing bookkeeping here. Okay, for one thing, one may say that one may define. Okay, one may define a subset. Right, one may define a subset of nodes A. Right. Which A sub n, shall we say, okay, which consists of all nodes A such that X A E, right, which is the corresponding nodal point, yeah, right, using the local node numbering, such that X A E belongs to partial of omega e sub j. Okay? Right? And then what one can do is simply restrict that sum to A lying in this set. Okay? In this case, I've used the subscript n to suggest that this is the set of nodes or degrees of freedom corresponding to the Neumann boundary data. Okay, so let's use this approach, right? So what we see then is that minus integral over this surface WHJN DS equals. Now again, I'll take several steps together, right? I'll do this, I'll pull our summation out, and I'll just say A belongs to the set we introduced, right? Script A sub n. Okay, we have here C A E, and I apologize, that C looks too much like an E. C A E integral over partial of omega E sub j n a j n d s. Okay, now we make another note, which is that we can of course convert from here to our parent subdomain, right? The parent domain from which we construct every single element. Okay, so in that setting, let's suppose that we are still talking of the same element here, and actually, let me go to the next slide to get this done. Now, we are going to elucidate a manner in which to carry out this integral, right? So for that purpose, let's suppose that we are now working with an element, right? Some general element and on this element, let's suppose that the surface of interest to us is this one, right? Let's suppose that this one is the surface partial of omega e sub j. Okay. Now, this element, of course, is always constructed from the same parent domain. Right, the nice regular element in this biunit domain. Okay. Right, we have that sort of a mapping. All right. So let's suppose, just for the purpose of argument, that the phase partial of omega e sub j is the mapping of that phase. Okay, and the way I've drawn things out, the phase of interest here, which I will mark just for the purpose of argument again, I'm going to mark this as partial of omega c sub j. Okay. It is the phase in the biunit domain, in the parent subdomain, that gets mapped onto the phase of interest to us, which is the phase on which we're imposing the Neumann boundary condition. Okay? Essentially, all we need to do here is now recognize that if we construct a sort of a lower dimensional mapping, right, which is the mapping that converts the area of this particular phase, right, the one marked as partial of omega e sub j, okay, which obtains this particular phase from omega c sub j. Okay, what we observe here is that the integral that we need to carry out, okay, which is coming from the previous slide, it is minus sum A belongs to A sub j C A E integral over omega E sub j N A J N D S, right? Let's observe that this thing can essentially be constructed as integral over partial of omega c sub j n a j n, right? And what we will do here is write determinant of, let me just write this as J sub S D S C. Okay? Where what I'm talking about here is the idea that for the mapping of the faces, we actually need to worry just about, we need to worry only about how to map from this phase, partial of omega c sub j, to partial of omega e sub j, okay? And js is that mapping, okay? So js, the tensor js is what we may define as the area coordinates, right, that correspond to a new set of variables, maybe x tilde 1 comma c 2, x tilde 1 comma C3, x tilde 2 comma C2, x tilde 2 comma C3. Okay, and what we mean by this is the following. If what we're referring to here is the following, if we look at the surface that we are working on in our physical domain, it is this one. Okay, so this is the surface partial of omega E sub j. Okay, what I'm suggesting is that we can now define local coordinates on this surface, right? And these local coordinates are what I'm referring to as x tilde 1, x tilde 2. Okay, all right? And these ones are obtained from a mapping of that face in the parent subdomain, which is C2, C3. Okay? And this is easy enough to do because in terms of C2 and C3, we can indeed express the local coordinates x tilde 1, x tilde 2. Okay, what we need to do here is define the map x tilde as a function of C2 and C3. All right? Okay, and then the determinant that we're talking of is simply the determinant of this particular mapping, right? The detail of how to construct this can sometimes seem challenging, especially if the surface partial omega E, as I've tried to represent here or here, is not a plane surface, okay? That takes a little more work, but it can essentially be done. Often, they will indeed be plane surfaces, and then this mapping is straightforward. In particular, if partial of omega E sub j is a coordinate surface, the mapping is actually is almost trivial, okay? So this is how we would go about doing it, right? So